Our next speaker, well, let me say this before I tell you his name. About 14 years ago, I attended a CLE seminar, and there were a number of attorneys speaking, and they were luminaries. Still, some of them still are in the trial bar, but there was one attorney there. He was a bit younger at the time. His name is Keenan Nix, and I have, to this day, never been more impressed with the energy, the passion, and the message that this speaker had. And I didn't even know who he was at the time, but I remember going back and looking up and reading about Keenan, and I have been impressed with him throughout his career. He is a successful trial lawyer. He had his own firm, and not surprisingly, the mega firm, Morgan & Morgan, recognized his ability and has hired him to be the leader of their firm here in Georgia, and he's going on to do tremendous things. And recently, in 2016, he had a contested case against Papa John's where they didn't even believe his client was injured, and he showed them, and the result was an $11 million verdict. He's tried multi-million dollar cases all over Georgia. He's been amazingly successful, and I am just excited to hear Keenan Nix speak again. And let's welcome Keenan.
Thank you, Rob. Great to see you. Good afternoon. I'm honored to be here. Rob, 14 years ago, you said. That's a lot of time that's passed, and I'm very thankful that some of the remarks that I was able to share, you found helpful and useful, because that's how we grow. Brandon just left you, and my mentor in this business was Jim Butler. And everything that you just heard Brandon share with you, I heard Jim share with me. And there aren't any new tricks with what we do. It's really your ability to master the old tricks, the foundations, the very basics that lead to the transcendent success that we all seek on behalf of our very deserving clients. I never turn down, if my schedule allows, an opportunity to present at functions like this, because I lived off of the instruction that I obtained during seminars like this as a young lawyer growing up. And I think it's our duty, it's our responsibility to give back to all of those who are in the game that we're in, representing clients who've been injured or killed, seeking justice on their behalf against insurmountable, incredible resources that we have to overcome with skill. You can't beat corporate defendants in a court of law where they have unlimited resources, where you're just half-stepping and faking it until you make it. And I'm here to talk about cross-examination. And I will tell you that in 25 years of practicing law, I've learned that there is no more important skill than the ability to cross-examine an adverse witness. We are engaged in a diligent search for the truth. And you don't get to the meat of the matter in any case unless you've got the skills to cross-examine a hostile witness who has incredible resources at their disposal. Some of them might be unbelievably educated. They've got the benefit of time. Some of them have defense institutes that invest thousands of dollars in cooking the science. And you've got to somehow, in a moment in time, using one skill and one skill alone, bring out the truth. And you can only do that through cross-examination. That's why it's an indispensable skill. So in this segment of our program, we're going to turn our attention to mastering the art of deposition taking, because the primary way we harvest evidence at trial is through depositions. That's what we do probably 75% of our time, is spent preparing to take depositions, because that's the way you harvest evidence, and the evidence that we harvest is what forms the discussion at trial. So cross-examination is everything, in my humble estimation. And if you don't master the art of deposition taking, then you will never be a great trial lawyer. You may settle some cases. You may get some cases resolved, but you won't win at trial unless you master the art of deposition taking, because how many of you know you don't go to trial asking a bunch of questions that you don't already know the answer to? Where did those answers come from? depositions. And I pay a lot of attention to depositions. My major depositions are exercises that only occur after 1, 2, 3 months of preparation. Look, I hear somebody say, I gotta go take this deposition. Let me just pull out a couple of little books and let's throw something together and go take a deposition tomorrow afternoon. That's unheard of to me. Because I spend months preparing for depositions. And when I finish the depositions, the case is over. Period. Put a fork in it. It's done. When I go back to my office, they don't even ask me how the deposition went because I've been giving them the same answer for 25 years. Kill. Done. Over. Why do I have that confidence? Because I prepared. I understood the importance of it before I began. And most of my cases end after that first deposition. I do a lot of medical malpractice work. So these depositions are important. 65% of what I do is deposing defendant doctors in high stakes medical malpractice cases. And invariably, after I take that deposition, the case is over. I went to my law partner the other day after one such deposition. I said, you can pick up the telephone and call Grady Hospital's lawyer. Tell him he's got a small window of opportunity to pay $3 million. Because he cannot like his case because his defendant doctor is done. He picked up the telephone, called him, right? Unlike what Brandon said, I beg to slightly disagree. Look, time is money in what we do. If I go kill the defendant doctor and he's done, he can't try the case against me, I'm gonna give him an opportunity to settle early. That's in my client's best interest because if I'm pushing this thing down the line in a medical malpractice case, that's $100,000. If I can save them the time, the trouble, I'm ready to go. I'm not begging. I'm not on my knees. I'm ready to finish this thing. We got this party started. I'm ready to finish it. But if I'm going to give them an early opportunity and it doesn't matter to me, I'm not begging, it's yay or nay. I'm going to show you a case where we gave them that same opportunity. They said no. They could have got that case done for $2 million. I took 3 more depositions just like that, and it was 5 by the time we finished. And I'm going to let you see it because much of what I'm talking about, you got to see it to appreciate it. And I'm going to show you some clips of what this looks like once you go through the exercise that hopefully you will embrace. Why take depositions? It's a rhetorical question, right? So let's begin by exploring why we take depositions. In a word, evidence. Evidence. That's what juries base their verdicts on. Who's got the most of it? We talk about the preponderance of it, the evidence, the burden of proof. What are we weighing? Evidence. Who's got it? Who came into this courtroom empty-handed? I tell these folks all the time, they got nothing to talk with you about. Zero. I've got the burden of proof. I accept that burden. It's my job to bring to you a preponderance of the evidence that persuades you in the rightness of my client's cause, and I got bushel loads of it, and they got nothing. Why? Because this trial is about evidence. So that's why you take depositions. In a sentence, you take depositions to develop evidence that advances your carefully refined theories of liability and damages. I'm not walking into these depositions clueless. I spend a bunch of time thinking about what I want to establish. I've already tried my case for months before I ever walk into the courtroom. Before I go take a deposition, I'm deciding what I want to be able to tell this jury that I got to get out of that witness's mouth. And that's the preparation time. Listen, an early trial lawyer taught me that the best thing you can do in your cases is take time to think. Most times lawyers are so busy, they don't even spend any time thinking about their case. I engage in a process that a lawyer taught me 25 years ago. It's called cerebration. That's just the mental exercise of thinking about what your case is really supposed to be about when you try it in front of a jury. And what it's going to take for you to get those indispensable components to be able to bring to that jury. That's, you got to think about that. That's why I said, in a word, you take depositions to develop evidence that advances what? Carefully refined theories of liability and damages. What do you want to prove on liability? You got to think about that, because that's the first start for you executing the strategy at deposition. What do I have to prove to win this case? And then, since we all know that we try these cases to get money for our deserving clients, you got to think about the whole issue of how you're going to develop damages through your depositions. Most lawyers that I know, they're so happy just to be able to prove their case, they don't even ask a single question in depositions about damages. And I want to show you a clip in just a minute, right, where I've got a defendant doctor making my damages case through every answer. Every time he says yes and correct, you go cha-ching. When you listen, every time he answers a question, you go cha-ching. Why? Because I'm getting their witness to establish my damages case. Who better to establish your damages case than through the hostile witness's mouth? If you do medical negligence work, you go look at that medical record, you've got spades of evidence to get right out of the defendant doctor's mouth that makes your damages case better than any fact witness or lay witness or expert witness that you hire ever could or would. But you've got to include that in your plan. And if that's not in your plan, you won't have that evidence when you get to trial. All right. In a nutshell, you take depositions to put the fear of God into your opponent and persuade them that this case cannot be defended in light of the record evidence you've developed by mastering the art of deposition. I want, at the end of the deposition, the guy on the other side of the room to be so demoralized that he knows, I better go find somebody else to try a case with, because I can't win this one. Your goal isn't, look, evidence is just the start. I want his heart. I want him to quit. I want him to know this is going to be a very painful exercise for you if we have to go try this case. I want him out. So I'm not just going for evidence. I'm not just going to ask questions about my theory of liability and my damages. All that's good. I want his heart. I want his will. Litigation is a battle of wills. It's survival of the fittest. You gotta know what you're after in these depositions. And that's a part of it. I want his will. And I'm gonna show you how I get it in just a moment. So how do we take these kinds of game-changing depositions? How do you do that? In a word, preparation. In a word, preparation. You got to take time to prepare. I told you, if it's a major deposition in my case, I'm preparing for that deposition for months. It is an arduous exercise. It is time consuming. It is labor intensive. It is exhausting. It is meticulous. But it's the whole case. Why not do it now? In a sentence, you take game-changing depositions by spending as much time as necessary defining case-specific goals and drafting a deposition outline that develops evidence in support of those goals. There's the outline of a deposition I recently took in a multi-million-dollar case where they quit. It's 22 pages long. Every question is typed out. It is meticulously organized. There ain't no playing games. This is a plan. This is the way you execute that plan. This is gold. This is money in the bank. That's the result of months of labor. I can't tell you how many times I've watched witnesses, I've watched lawyers come to depose my clients, and they just took a scratch pad on the airplane to the deposition, just started scratching out little notes. You say, well, I've been a lawyer for 25 years. I can just figure out all my questions. I can handle my business. Well, you're not that good. Who told you you were that good? You better prepare. You better write those questions out. You better develop those silver bullet questions, because the truth of the matter is, you're not that good. And you need the time to think through the logic of those questions, anticipate their responses, close the circle off of the back door when you know that they're gonna try to, when they're gonna try to run. That takes time. And if you're not spending that kind of time, you're not getting the depositions and the evidence that you need to go win a trial. That's a fact. In a nutshell, you take game-changing depositions by taking the time to outline a winning strategy and then executing that strategy to perfection. Above all else, if you hear nothing else this morning or afternoon, hear me when I tell you that game-changing depositions are about control. That one word, that's what you're after, control. There's only one sheriff in the room when I'm taking depositions, and I'm it. It's not the lawyer on the other side, it's damn sure not the witness. And that's apparent after about 5 minutes. It's surely apparent after an hour. And by the time we quit, there is no doubt. You're after control. Does that mean 30 minutes left?
30 minutes left.
Thank you. And control comes from impeccable logic, meticulous preparation, and indefatigable patience. What do you mean? Those are big words. Let me break it down. When I use the term impeccable logic in relationship to the principle of control, I'm referring to drafting silver bullet questions that are so pregnant with logic and common sense that only one answer is appropriate, and if any other answer is given, the witness looks like a fool. Impeccable logic. For example, just yesterday, I asked a commercial truck driver in a traumatic brain injury case, where after that deposition, they will tender the $1 million limits. Mr. Bobo, you admit in sworn discovery responses that you were driving 70 miles per hour southbound on I-75, listen, just 2 or 3 car lengths behind another tractor trailer, and that is the very definition of unsafe truck drive, unsafe tailgating. True? He just looks at me. Do you need for me to repeat the question? You're driving a 28,000 pound tractor trailer 2 to 3 car lengths behind another tractor trailer, where you know at 55 miles per hour, it takes you the length of a football field or 6 to 7 seconds to bring that vehicle to a stop. That's the very definition of tailgating. Am I right, sir? Of course he gives me the right answer. If he doesn't, he's a fool. What truck driver doesn't know that you can't drive a rig like that? And that's exactly what he was doing in this case. And that leads predictably to an accident where he's tearing up the whole road, causing all kinds of mayhem, and my client gets caught up in that nonsense, and they're gonna pay. Why? Because he can't. That's a silver bullet question. There's only one answer to that question that matters. If he doesn't give it to me, what is he? So I don't even care. When you draft the right question, you don't even care what the answer is, because it's so full of impeccable logic and common sense, you win. Listen to me. Now, Mr. Bobo answered that silver bullet question, yes, but I did not care how he responded, because he was damned if he did and damned if he didn't. And that's the power of impeccable logic. By drafting silver bullet questions with impeccable logic requires meticulous preparation. Sometimes, listen to me, I spend 30 minutes crafting a single question. Why? Because that question is important. And I'm going in on this question. This is the whole case. And I want it to be perfect. and getting honest answers to meticulously prepared silver bullet questions sometimes requires indefatigable patience. In other words, trapped witnesses often will fight to get out of the trap you've laid by impeccable logic, and you must persist until you get the answer compelled by common sense. How many times have you seen that, Rob? You know you've asked the guy the right question, but he's over there running like a little caged cat trying to get out, and he's saying this and saying that. This guy, I mean, yesterday he was in this deposition, and his lawyers drafted a litigation-generated discovery response that this guy with a ninth grade education, I didn't know he had a ninth grade education until the first 5 minutes of the deposition. But that made sense to me because this was a two-page interrogatory response where you ask him to describe your version of how the accident occurred. It went on for two pages. It was totally different from what was in the police report. You know the lawyer wrote the interrogatory response. Then I find out this guy has a ninth grade education, and I knew he didn't write that response because he could barely read it when I put it in front of him. So I knew what the deal was. And then it didn't make sense, but now it's his answer because he's sworn to it. And so I was asking him questions. I was just toying with him and playing with him. He was trying to run, right? And I was asking him these questions, and it was just a comical exercise. But sometimes trapped witnesses will try to run, and you've got to persist. Sometimes they try to change your question. Thank you very much for that answer, sir. But I didn't even ask you that question. I'm going to repeat the question that I asked you that you didn't answer once again. Madam Court Reporter, will you please repeat the question? That's persistence. And what I mean by persistence is sometimes you get these smart witnesses. All the witnesses in these medical malpractice cases know that I'm not a doctor, and they've been to medical school. They come from Yale. They come from Harvard. They come from all over the world. They've written all these publications. They've got CVs that are 250 pages, and they're looking at this little African-American lawyer from Georgia, and they think I'm a jackass, right? But I know more about that little slice of medicine, right, because I've gone 6 miles deep. Only 1 inch wide, but 6 miles deep, and I know this medicine, and you're not gonna piss on my leg and tell me it's raining outside. Give me the right answer. And I get the right answer. Why? Because I'm persistent. I know the truth. You know I know the truth. I've been reading your mail. I've read all of your literature. Give me the right answer. We'll be here forever. We can do this quick or we can do this long, but I'm staying until I get the truth that I came here for my client. Period. End of story. Control. Let me talk with you about control for just a minute. You got to prepare to have that kind of control. I read every discovery response, word for word, 15 times, backwards and forwards. Every one of them. I read every request for admission. I go through that. I got the medical record memorized like an encyclopedic knowledge. I've looked at that thing backwards and forward. I've translated it. I've had my people translate it. I've had my legal assistants go through. I've got my legal nurse consultants giving me all kinds of medical research. I'm armed and loaded for bear. And that takes time. Preparation, though, gives you control because after a while, they know you know this record way better than they do. Look, I'll depose these witnesses and I'll be going through their credentials, right? I know their CVs better than they know their CVs. I'll find mistakes on their CVs that they should have corrected 10 years ago. Doctor, don't you think it's about time that you correct that CV? Yes, sir. Thank you very much for pointing that out. What am I teaching them? I know this case backwards and forwards. Don't play with me. I got this. I got this. I got this. This is mine. I own this. Control, preparation. Organization. You can't go into a deposition bumbling around. You don't want to try cases that way, and you don't want to depose witnesses that way. I walk into a deposition. This is my outline. Every single one of the sections I'm going through is meticulously organized. I meet court reporters. I've never had a court reporter pre-mark one of my exhibits ever. They say, it's a pleasure working with you, Mr. Nix. All your exhibits are already marked. Yes, they are. I don't want to break the flow of my deposition by sitting around, could you get me a sticker so I can mark this, you know, and fumbling around. No, let's be surgical here. Because when you're prepared and you're organized, that lets this witness know, play with somebody else, don't play with you. That's what you got to do. Okay, so everything you do should success to them control. When I go to these medical depositions, I've got the definitive textbooks for that subject matter under consideration stacked right next to me, turned around with the spine facing him so he knows my wood ain't wet. I know what your Bible is, and I've read it. I got his CV with all of his articles. I'll go through the articles. I'll be talking with him about it. I said, doctor, I'm just going to be showing you some excerpts from these articles. But just in case you're wondering and you want to see the whole article, I got that in my briefcase, too. Yardstick. Liability is about a yardstick. How does a jury know if somebody has done something wrong if you don't have a yardstick by which to compare them? So the yardstick is everything. You've got to give them the yardstick. That's called the standard of care. That's liability, right? When I'm in my standard of care section, doctor, this is the yardstick by which your conduct in this case is going to be measured. Let's talk about it, right? That gives you control. In other words, you got to be the subject matter expert. If it's a police brutality case, you got to know the rules of the game. If it's a medical malpractice case, you got to know the standard of care. If it's a premises liability case, you got to know the standards of security that apply to that circumstance and situation. You got to define that. You got to master that. You got to know that. You got to own that. What does this give you? Amazing flexibility. If you're prepared, you're organized, you know the subject matter, you're flexible. Because you see that outline covers 90% of what we're supposed to be talking about, but occasionally and invariably, there's always a twist and a turn. But when you're well prepared, you're well organized, you know what you're talking about, you're nimble. Mental agility is key in depositions because it's not always gonna go exactly the way you plan for it to go. And yet the preparation, the organization, and the knowledge of the subject matter is what gives you the ability on a moment's notice, on a dime as it were, to nimbly and flexibly go where you have to go to get the job done. That's control. Invariably, the landscape will change on you. And all of a sudden, you lose control if you sit there with the deer in the headlights look like, okay, now what do I do? And finally, you get control by persistence. I get my best depositions and answers in my depositions in hour 5 or 6. Why? Because I'm persistent and I'm wearing them down. This isn't new energy for me. I have this energy all the time. And when they break and go to lunch, Mr. Nix, do you want a lunch break? No, sir. You go to lunch. I'll be here when you get back. I bring a banana to the deposition. I want them to know I'm here for business. I'll eat with my wife and my kids at home. I done come to this deposition to eat with you. I came to this deposition to take your will. You go to lunch. I'll be here when you get back. And I sit right there at the table. If I happen to be at Alston and Byrd, they have a damn commissary right there in the conference room. I just wander over to their snack bar and eat their food. But I ain't leaving. I'll be here when you get back. Why? I want them to know this is my show. And I ain't leaving until I'm done. All right. Let me give you very quickly some components of game-changing depositions, and I'm going to show you what it looks like. Right? When I do an introduction, I tell them exactly how this thing is gonna play out. And one important part of my introduction is introducing them to this concept that I call paper control. How many of you have ever heard of a scientist called Pavlov? Okay? There's a principle out there called Pavlovian conditioning. By repeatedly ringing a bell at feeding time, Pavlov taught us that you can make a dog salivate just by ringing the bell, even when there's no food present. Because he associates the bell ringing with food. And I use the principle of Pavlovian conditioning to control witnesses and make them behave. Listen to me. By repetitive action, you can condition witnesses to behave. And this is how I do it. I don't ask a single question at a deposition without putting a piece of paper in front of the witness. I don't care if it's his name. Right? And invariably, you put something in front of a witness, he's going to read it. And so I start out by doing that, and you'll see that technique. Every question I ask, I'm putting a piece of paper, and there they are in the outline. Every piece of paper from the record, outlined and highlighted. Sometimes at the very beginning, it looks like very simple stuff, but I'm conditioning the witness. What I'm conditioning him to understand, if I put something in front of you, it's accurate, it's true, it's complete, because I'm prepared. And by the time I get to hour five, I'm putting stuff in front of the witness. I'm not even asking that question anymore, but he's answering yes to my questions because he's already been conditioned that if I put a piece of paper in front of him, I'm already telling him the right information. Why'd I learn that? Lloyd, I learned that because when I went to my first couple of medical malpractice depositions and I started asking these folks questions, right? If you notice in medical malpractice depositions, when the doctor comes, they don't even put the chart out there for him. And when I would ask him facts about the case, he would say, I haven't memorized the case. And so I said, well, didn't you read the chart and prepare for your death? He says, but yes, Mr. Nix, I have lots of patients. I'm a busy man. So I started putting every fact to every question that I asked in front of him because I was never going to let that happen again. In other words, have a witness come to a deposition and just play dumb just because he can say, look, I haven't memorized all the facts. So I put it down there in front of him, and then I found out a wonderful thing. It gave me unbelievable control over the witness. And so I started doing that in every case. And one of the things that I'm doing with that paper is I'm defining the standard of care, I'm using that paper to prove liability, and I'm also establishing damages. And I want to show it to you, right, if we can get ready, in a couple of videos, right? I want you to listen to my introduction, and I tell these folks what the game rules are. And then after that, I'm going to go into to paper control and let you watch how the paper control takes hold. And then I'm going to show you a final clip, which I call total destruction in a medical malpractice case where the defendant doctor after one deposition gave me the whole case. Let's look at what this looks like. Listen to the introduction very carefully. Good morning, Mr. Booth.
That is.
My name is Keenan Nix. And I'll be asking you a series of questions today about your designation as an expert witness in the case styled Lafreda Watkins versus MRB Inc., doing business as 50 Yard Line Sports Bar and Grill and WH Tri-County Shopping Center LLC. I hope that all of my questions this morning are clear, but if I should fail in my mission and ask you a question that you do not fully understand, will you agree to ask me to rephrase the question and do not attempt to answer a question that you do not fully understand?
I will.
Likewise, if you can continue to give me nice, crisp, audible answers, this is a large conference room and everyone here is very interested in what you have to say. So those audible answers not only will help us understand your testimony, it'll assist Madam Court Reporter in accurately transcribing it. Fair enough?
Fair enough.
Likewise, I'm gonna be showing you some documents to facilitate our conversation this afternoon. My purpose in doing so is just that. To facilitate our conversation and direct your attention to certain facts which are of interest to me. But in showing you my documents, I'm not by any means limiting whatever you wish to review in order to fully and accurately respond to my questions. Is that fair?
That's fair.
All right. I just laid the ground rules. I told him I'm going to be showing him a series of documents to facilitate our conversation. Next, I'm going to show you how that paper control works. Watch the paper being passed with each question. And watch the witness, more importantly, look down at every question that I put at him, looking exactly at what I've highlighted, like a dog in Pavlov's experiment. And then watch him at the end of the experiment articulate that he understands the conditioning exactly the way that I wanted him to. Watch. Paper control. Mr. Booth, let's talk about your credentials for the next few moments. I show you where I've marked this plaintiff's exhibit number 2 and ask you to confirm that the CV before you is a current copy of your professional resume describing your professional background and training.
It is.
And you provided me a duplicate copy of that same CB this morning.
Sure, I did.
Paper control.
Mr. Booth, you are the chairman of the board at Risk Management Associates, correct?
That's correct.
And Risk Management Associates is a security consulting and investigative firm, true?
That's correct.
Mr. Booth, RMA has a client list of about 800 business entities, corporations, and governmental entities, correct?
Well, that's somewhat in flux, as it would be with any business. We gain clients and we lose clients. We rarely lose clients, but we continue to gain clients. But it's somewhere between 800, 900
He's
clients.
Looking at his former deposition
testimony. And RMA sells those business entities, corporations, and governmental entities. It's consultants' time and advice as it relates to security matters. True?
That's correct.
Mr. Booth, you share in the ownership at Risk Management Associates, correct?
I do.
More specifically, you have an ownership share of approximately 20%. True?
That's correct.
Mr. Booth, you are a security consultant.
For time, I'm going to fast forward
correct?
To the last segment of this deposition.
And you consider yourself to be an expert in physical security?
So you see the end.
Of Tri-County Shopping Center has a duty to keep its premises safe for business invitees like LaFreda Watkins. True?
True.
Watch this little colloquy in just a minute.
In fact, you also would agree that the owner of Tri-County Shopping Center also has a duty to protect business invitees like LaFreda Watkins from possible risks of harm, correct?
Yes, can I add something at this point?
But
you may, sir.
And this is not a criticism, but each time when you ask me a question, as I'm sure it'll be obvious on the video, you're placing a piece of paper in front of me.
Paper control!
I'm not testifying as to what's on these pieces of paper because now we're in dozens easily. I'm testifying as to the questions that you're asking me. So if there's something about this piece of paper that you would like for me to review and testify to, then I would appreciate it if you would ask specifically about the paper. I don't mind you putting the paper down there, but I just want to make it clear that I'm answering the question and not testifying about these documents that you're placing in front of me.
I appreciate your clarification. I am directing your attention to the papers I'm putting in front of you. You've been testifying in expert security cases like this, and I've got several of your depositions, and I'm just facilitating the conversation, asking you the same questions you've been asked under oath dozens of times.
Are you asking me to review the document that you put in front of me each time?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Well, I will start doing that then.
He'd been doing it for the last 20 minutes, answering every question I asked, starting with his credentials, right down through the standard of care, and every answer was yes, true, correct, yes, true, correct, because that's all he could do because I had read every deposition the man had given for the past 12 years. That's control, and the paper was what was controlling him, and with his own mouth, he articulated it and pretended like he wasn't looking at the paper when he was looking at the paper the whole time. Total destruction, and I'm done. 8 minutes. I'm done. This is a 7-minute tape in a $3 million case that was over after this deposition of the defendant, doctor. And I appreciate your time.
Dr. Delorier, on May 10th at 11:01 a.m., you saw Mrs. Moon in the ICU and noted that she was hemodynamically unstable and nonsensical at times, secondary to a presumptive diagnosis of sepsis. True?
True.
She was out of her mind in pain. Is that a fair statement, sir?
I don't know if she's out of her mind in pain. She may have been out of her mind because of the sepsis.
For the first time since admitting her on May 8th you actually physically examined Barbara Moon's extremities and noted that she had a long incision on the right knee and a mottled appearance around her knee, correct?
Correct.
And then and now, you claim that you had absolutely no knowledge that Barbara Moon was taking multiple antibiotics for an active knee infection until after you had already subjected her to the risk of undergoing two procedures. True?
That's correct.
Dr. DeLaurier, on May 10th at 12:30 p.m., Mrs. Moon's previous antifungal mycamine finally was restarted over 48 hours after her admission. Correct?
Correct.
That's not how this was supposed to work, was it, Doctor?
No, sir.
Between 12 p.m. and 3:56 p.m. on May 10th, Mrs. Moon was examined by orthopedic surgeon Dr. Larry Metters, who causally related Mrs. Moon's sudden onset of sepsis to likely infected right total knee replacement and recommended removal of prosthesis and debridement when stable. True?
True.
Would you agree with me that the failure to administer antibiotics more likely than not caused Mrs. Moon to develop sepsis during the post-op period as documented in the medical records we've been reviewing?
I think more than likely that's true.
Causation out of the defendant, Dr. Ismail.
On May 10 at 4 p.m., Dr. Milos Tukovic, a critical care physician, noted that Mrs.
Damages
Moon
testimony
has the appearance
out of, the defendant,
of
Dr.
septic
Smell.
Shock and is getting profoundly worse, close quote, secondary to hypotension, tachycardia, and hypoxia. Correct?
That's correct.
That's a picture of a patient who is dying a slow and painful death as a direct result of sepsis poisoning her system with infection, isn't it, Doctor?
Well, I don't agree with every term, but I think generally that's correct.
He's mine.
Upon noting, quote, she is in panic, gasping for air, close quote, Dr. Tukovic intubated Mrs. Moon in order to help her breathe. True?
True.
Damages.
On May 11, 2012, Mrs. Moon remained tachycardic, hypotensive, and febrile. Correct?
Yes.
Tangible signs and symptoms that sepsis was causing her rapid demise. Agreed?
I agree.
After more than 24 hours of respiratory failure, acute renal insufficiency, and severe septic shock, Dr. Kukovic wrote a do not resuscitate order on May 11 at 8:49 p.m. True?
True.
And after
paper
roughly
control.
11 more hours of suffering, Barbara Moon died in the ICU on May 12, 2012 at 7:40 a.m. Correct?
Yes, she died.
Pain and suffering.
And she clearly suffered before she died, as evidenced by these medical records.
Yes.
Correct?
Pain and suffering. Out of the defendant, Dr.'s mouth.
Barbara Moon's death certificate lists sepsis as the cause of death. True?
That's true.
And the medical chart that we've been reviewing this afternoon makes clear that prior to her admission on May 8, 2012, Mrs. Moon had been on multiple antibiotics for an infected right knee joint. Correct?
Yes.
Liability.
But as a direct result of medication reconciliation errors at Athens Regional Medical Center, Mrs. Moon's antibiotic therapy was not continued on admission to that hospital.
True?
That's true.
And within 48 hours of being admitted to Athens Regional Medical Center by you, without continuation of her antibiotics, Barbara Moon became septic after undergoing two procedures, which quickly progressed to septic shock and eventually caused her death. Correct?
Correct.
Would you agree that the system of care failed Barbara Moon after you admitted her on May 8th by not continuing her antibiotic therapy due to medical reconciliation errors?
I agree.
Boom. Over.
Dr.
$3
million.
Give that man his money. Why? Indefatigable patience, impeccable logic, preparation, paper control, and we were right. Now, every deposition I take reads exactly like that. And that's not a joke. If you want to see the transcript, just call me up. I'll send you anyone in any kind of case, right? But it all is the result of control. And it takes time, it takes preparation, it takes organization, it takes an understanding of the standard of care. And if you're willing to do the work, you can control your witnesses too. Thank you very much.
Questions for Keenan. All right, fantastic.
Yes, sir.
Wow, you've even gotten better.
Always a pleasure.
Well, if there was ever a mic drop at an ICLE, that was it. I mean, I'm going to get a copy of this video and play it for myself before every deposition I take just to motivate me to do better. Thanks so much, Keenan. We're going to take a break now.